Hello and welcome. You're watching Big Picture with me, Vishal Dahiya, and today we're going to talk about the investment opportunities in India's healthcare sector. In fact, Niti Aayog has released a report recently outlining the range of investment opportunities in various segments of India's healthcare sector, including hospitals, medical devices and equipment, health insurance, telemedicine, home healthcare, and medical value travel as well. The report says that India's healthcare industry has been growing at a compound annual growth rate of around 22% since 2016. Now, at this rate, it is expected to reach $372 billion in 2022. Healthcare has become one of the largest sectors of the Indian economy in terms of both revenue and employment. In fact, in 2015, the healthcare sector became the fifth largest employer, employing 4.7 million people directly. As per estimates by the National Skill Development Corporation, that is NSDC, healthcare can generate 2.7 million additional jobs in India between 2017 and 2022. That means over 5 lakh new jobs per year. So we're going to look at all those aspects, also how these facts and figures can be further realized, as the report says. And to understand things more clearly, we have with us a distinguished panel of experts. Let me first introduce them to you, beginning with Ms. Urvashi Prasad, Public Policy Specialist at Niti Aayog, looking after the health segment. We also have with us Mr. Bishnu Panigrahi. He is the Group Head of Medical Strategy and Operations at Fortis Healthcare. Welcome, both of you. And let me begin with you, Urvashi, since you played a very crucial and important part in compilation of this report as well. If you could take us through the key highlights as to, you know, the few sectors I mentioned and, you know, the few figures I mentioned as well. If you could put them in perspective, what exactly is the report conveying and where are the opportunities here?
Right. Thank you very much, Vishal, for inviting me for this. And yes, as you mentioned, you know, the healthcare sector is one which has already shown robust growth over the last several years. But the potential, we believe, is much higher, both in terms of, you know, the impact on the economy, in terms of employment generation. And it is with this context that we actually brought out this report, which seeks to, as you mentioned, all these different segments of the healthcare sector, right, from pharmaceuticals to medical devices to telemedicine to home healthcare. We've looked at each of these. Where are we today? What are the major challenges that we are facing? Because, you know, of course, there have been some historical challenges that we've had. For instance, if we look at the pharma and the medical devices sectors, we are still very dependent on imports. And that is something we want to really address as part of this Atmanirbhar Bharat initiative. Also, our potential for exports is much higher in many of these areas. So those are some challenges that have been long-standing, but there are also some challenges and opportunities that the COVID pandemic has brought with it. We do know the challenges. Many segments of the healthcare sector have obviously been impacted by those, but the opportunities in terms of digitization, telemedicine, home healthcare, those are also tremendous. So given this, the report we have basically put out for each of these segments, where we are today, where we expect to be in the future. We've also put out a future outlook. We've looked at different projections that, you know, different industry bodies have made, Invest India has made. And we've also listed out the policy, the enabling policy measures that have been brought out in the last few years, you know, because the government, as many of you would be aware, has brought out a series of steps and measures for the health system, right, from Ayushman Bharat to the National Digital Health Mission, to most recently the production-linked incentive schemes for pharma and medtech. So there is a lot more that needs to be done. And that's what we have also spoken about in the report, that given that, you know, we have this historical context, given that we have these new challenges and opportunities in the light of the pandemic, where do we go from here? And what are those major investment avenues in each of these segments? That is what we have essentially tried to put out in this report.
Okay, fair enough. Let me also bring in Mr. Bishnu Panigrahi here, who's with us. Mr. Panigrahi, from your point of view and from industry's point of view as well, if you could, tell us your views on not only these areas which have been identified under this report in terms of the opportunities for investment in the healthcare sector, but also the road ahead and what exactly does the industry think in terms of, these opportunities?
Vishal, thank you for inviting me, and I'd like to first commend Urvashi and Niti Aayog for bringing this report out. We have been always looking at healthcare as someone who just patient falls sick, you go and treat. But I think so. We are what they've really rightfully outlined is the employment opportunities. In fact, this is in most of the talks that I've been interacting with. I've been stressing on this. Please look at healthcare. One is the curative part of it, but it's a huge employment generator. And it is another part of the Atmanirbhar program that the government and under Mr. Modi's leadership has rolled out. You can't expect the government to keep providing jobs. It has to be an enabler to do this. I think this is an enabling environment that is being put up by Niti Aayog. They are showing us the roadmap. And healthcare, if you look at it, more than 60% to 70% of the workforce are women. I'm being very specific here. And this is across all the healthcare chains. So what does that imply? It implies mm-hmm. that if in the we have a larger workforce from the females, there's a social upliftment. Because, Vishal, don't mind my words, but females, they put the money that they bring home to better use than we men. So that's a very important part of the social upliftment that we're looking at.
Now, that then indeed is, that the, indeed is also, the truth there, Mr. Panigrahi.
Yeah, and then down the line also, it's not only the hospital. It is, if you look at the environment outside the hospital, there are a lot of people who get employment from that. And I think so this pandemic has shown us certain things that there is a huge opportunity that healthcare has, potential that it has. I think so. I give kudos to the Niti Aayog, the way they have brought this up. And it is just, I think so, we are seeing the green shoots, and there's a lot of potential as far as only not only the healthcare treating patients, looking at the medical value travel, the medical tourism that you're talking about. We can be the pharmacy capital of the world. And that's another huge potential that is there. Medical devices, as Urvashi rightly mentioned, most of it that we use in our hospitals are imported. So we are probably after China, we are the largest market. So this is something that we need to leverage. The manufacturers, they should put up shop in India and increase the production here. So with partnerships, because the government has been very liberal as far as that single window clearance is concerned. So this is something that needs to come in. Telemedicine has shown a huge potential during this pandemic. The other thing is, I think so, how do you keep people healthy? So this is something that there's a lot of focus coming up, especially with this non-communicable disease coming up, diabetes, high blood pressure, or you're seeing cancers going up. So I think so. The how to keep people healthy is something mm-hmm. that we need to stress on. So for that, you don't require to come to a major hospitals. A lot of telemedicine and the diagnostics chains properly working will fill in this gap.
Okay. Those are really important aspects there, which are being pointed out by Mr. Panigrahi. Urvashi, one thing which is mentioned very prominently in the report there as well, and Mr. Panigrahi also referred to it, I believe you also mentioned that in your previous response, is how the present situation, that's vis-a-vis, I'm referring to the COVID-19 pandemic here, has sort of brought that change in that long-term outlook towards personal health, hygiene, even, other aspects of the healthcare sector like health insurance as well. So if we're looking that as a sort of infector here, how do you believe, it has sprouted or it has helped in bringing that change, and how can we further build upon that change when you're talking about the opportunities there? And this has that ripple effect in terms of generating more employment as well and giving benefits to all those concerned.
That's right. This, as I said, this has been obviously a very challenging phase, but we have seen these tremendous opportunities coming up. And I think one of the ones that we've tried to really emphasize in the report, in addition to telemedicine, of course, is also home healthcare. Because we have to remember that, we also have a population which is aging. While we always think of India as, young people and people under 35, we also have a significant number of older people, and that number is only going to go up in the years to come. We already have an increasing burden of the non-communicable or the chronic diseases. And what all of this means is that you would need constant monitoring of health status, constant care, constant attention. So that does open up the home healthcare segment in a big way. Till now, it has been fairly nascent in India, and that's something we also mentioned, acknowledge in the report. But there's huge potential, and that is also where a lot of employment can be generated. As was very rightly mentioned, that our employment is not going to come just from hospitals, but in fact from all the additional cadres of health professionals that we can develop due to these opportunities, the caregivers, the allied health professionals. So there's huge opportunities there. And also in terms of medical devices, for instance, I think we are going to move more and more towards people becoming interested in tracking their own health, in promoting their own wellness. So the nature of medical devices that we use also, so far medical devices that we make domestically has been quite basic, what we call the class A and the class B devices. And most of the high-tech, high-end devices we actually either import or we have the multinationals who actually manufacture them. But I think there is an opportunity for us to change that and also get into that high-tech segment. And also look at these newer types of devices that people might now demand. We already have spoken of things like wearables and smart sensors. And a lot of these things will open up post the pandemic, because I think people are now realizing that it's not just about going to a hospital and curing a disease. It's about staying well. And it's about promoting your wellness and promoting your fitness. So I think a lot of these changes are going to be brought about because of the pandemic. And therefore, they will also impact on the nature of services and products that are demanded from different segments of the healthcare industry. So I think those are some of the issues that we've also tried to bring out through this report, and also highlight that these are the areas we need to focus going forward from here.
Okay. So these are the areas which we have, we're talking about right now, which the report seemingly has highlighted in terms of investment opportunities. We've understood the rationale and the reason behind that as well. But in terms of policy here, Urvashi, before I go to Mr. Panigrahi again, in terms of policy tweaks, reforms or structural changes which the government might be working upon, or some which have already been brought in to complement or supplement, these opportunities there, so that they can be, taken note of.
Right. So I think some of, I think health as a sector, fortunately has got very high policy priority over the last few years. Even before the pandemic, we started seeing a number of structural systemic reforms being brought in by the government, right from all the medical education reforms to Ayushman Bharat, to the National Digital Health Mission. So the government is constantly trying to bring in reforms in different aspects of this sector. Now, after the pandemic, we saw the Atmanirbhar Bharat Abhiyan, and as part of that, the pharmaceutical and the medical devices sectors have got a lot of importance. So we've already had the performance-linked incentive schemes being announced for those. And of course, the idea here very much is to reduce our dependence on imports, and also make us our own domestic manufacturing much more globally competitive, make us be able to get a much larger share of the global market as well through our exports. So I think the intention there is very clear. What we might see even in the next few months or in the way ahead from the government is an additional impetus to research in these areas, because we also need cutting edge research in pharmaceuticals and medical devices. So we might even see additional schemes or initiatives in that area coming in, because the PLI is specifically focused on production and domestic manufacturing, but we're also looking at research and innovation, because those are also critical for this entire sector. So that is something that you might see, coming in the months. Telemedicine is something, many of you know, the government has had already launched the telemedicine guidelines. just at the start of the pandemic in India. And that is also something that we will be giving a much stronger push to implement different kinds of telemedicine models in states, at our health and wellness centers, for instance, as well as then look at home healthcare. And that okay. is, again, you know, one final point I'll make here, that during the pandemic, insurance, we actually included home stay and home care for COVID in our insurance programs. Now, that is something that could pave the way for a much broader, you know, inclusion of services when we talk of insurance. You know, traditionally, we've looked at insurance only as hospital-related services being covered, but that could also move into the home healthcare arena now. So I think okay. these are some of the areas where a lot of policy action has happened, and you will see more in the months to come for sure.
Okay, indeed. So there are the key areas in terms of, you know, policy there as well. Mr. Panigrahi, you know, if you're looking at the industry's point of view on these policy changes or the required changes in the near future as well, you know, to stay in tune with the opportunities there. Also, you know, I'd like to seek your views on that PPP model. You know, is this a preferred sort of movement ahead now in the healthcare sector? Because we're seeing quite a lot of, you know, suggestions on it coming and, you know, this model getting a lot of traction there.
I think so. It's like reaching to the converted, if you can put it that way. Just 2 years back, for 2 years, I was in Bhubaneswar. I had was part of the KIMS thing. And I came back in October there from back to Delhi. And we were involved with a public-private partnership for COVID, specifically for COVID with the government of Orissa. On 26th of the March, we signed the MOU with the government of Orissa. On 2nd of April, this chief minister inaugurated it. On 3rd, the hospital was ready. On 5th, the first patient came in. And this same model was replicated with other private healthcare providers. The reason was that the government realized that the public sector may not be able to ramp up quickly. It's not that public sector is inefficient. I'm not saying that. It is that to quickly ramp up, scale up. So there was a lot of spare capacity with the private sector to ramp up quickly. And they were very nimble in the feet. They got it going. And the organization that I was taking care of put up 1,050 beds within a week, 500 beds in Bhubaneswar, and 200, 150 in three district headquarters in tribal areas. Mm-hmm. So not a single patient in Orissa had to run around where to go to, which happened across the metros. So I think the public-private partnership is a model that needs to be developed. And I think so it's the way forward, because I'm very clear about certain things. I may be working in the private sector, but healthcare transcends everything, whether it's private, public. So we need to keep our people healthy. So obviously the private sector, they need to have a profit, so that because someone is investing, they have to build up. And that profit is again invested again in growth, because medical equipment, if you look at it, 7 to 8 years, maximum 10 years is the lifespan of any equipment. So once it becomes obsolete, you have to buy a new. Your instruments, surgical instruments, they last for 2-3 years. They have to again. So that, but a model is available, I think. So that has not been explored. But what I'm trying to tell is that my 9 months experience of handling COVID with mm-hmm. the government of Orissa, it was a excellent case study by itself. That is a model that I think so Niti Aayog, the government, and other state governments should start explore it. And I'm very confident that public sector is open to having a reasonable public-private partnership, where it's a win-win for both sides.
Okay, fair enough. And on the policy framework and the changes, you know, which are being brought in and which might be required therein as well.
Yes. Because see, the opportunity actually lies in the tier 2 and tier 3 cities, where Niti Aayog has rightfully pointed out. It is too much skewed towards the major cities, which I call India. There is a Bharat outside India, which is in the tier 2, tier 3 cities. And I think the focus has to be there. That is where the growth is. And if you look at a demographic dividend, we should try to see that those areas are also taken care of. So I think since we are talking about investment opportunities, we should be looking at tier 2, tier 3 cities and the small towns also. Because even if you look at any hospital, even a small hospital above 50 beds, are given tax rebates. So these things have not been disseminated down. down the line. So I think so there's a huge opportunity to take investment into the tier 2, tier 3 cities and into the Indian hinterland, which I call Bharat.
Okay, definitely. That is the key to the investment opportunities there, looking beyond the metro cities and places where actually there is a requirement for stronger healthcare facilities there in lies the opportunities. There's both Mr. Panigrahi and Urvashi is pointing out. Urvashi, concluding comment from you on the PPP aspect there, as Mr. Panigrahi was pointing out with an example which he cited, looks like that's the best way to move forward, and you know, one of the best ways, if not best, and it needs to be explored further as well.
Yes, absolutely. And I think the pandemic, you know, also showed us that, you know, when we had large scale collaboration between the public and the private sectors, we could actually ramp up, you know, production of PPEs, masks, ventilators. You know, we were almost at zero manufacturing levels at the start of the pandemic. And today we're in a position where we can actually export to, you know, other countries. So definitely the scale, the efficiency, that a public-private partnership can bring in is tremendous. And therefore, we have also started looking at some of these schemes very seriously. So there is a viability gap funding scheme, which the government has actually announced recently. And we've also outlined this in the report, which is for upgrading district hospitals. And this is something which can happen through the public-private partnership route. And we are actually, as Niti Aayog, we are even hand-holding, you know, different states to walk them through the scheme and to help them, you know, build these public-private partnerships. So I think we will, that is definitely the way to go forward. And we will see a lot more of this. We will also see, you know, as mentioned, that there's some state governments that have very good examples. So we are also continually, as Niti Aayog, we are continually trying to learn from those examples and also disseminate them in the different programs and the different schemes that that we support the implementation of. So I think that is definitely the route forward, the way forward. And I think that is what we will see happening a lot more in the months and years to come.
Okay, and one last quick word on in terms of what exactly is the expectation from the industry there. I'm asking this because Mr. Panigrahi is also on the panel here. What does, you know, the Niti Aayog, those who prepared the report, those who are advising the government on policy issues, what do they expect in terms of the industry to work it out?
I think, so I think there is definitely a partnership here, and that is the approach we'd have to take forward. We as Niti Aayog, we constantly try to feed in the concerns that are there from the industry side into policy making, because, you know, that's really one of our major roles as well. And that therefore we actually put out this report also with that spirit. You know, we would love to have more feedback and insights from the industry, and also for them to come forward and say these are our bottlenecks. But of course, you know, I think policy is something that, you know, over a period of time we see the changes. So we might not see every bottleneck or challenge getting addressed immediately, but we are constantly here to put that perspective forward to the ministries, to the states, so that we can make this partnership work as effectively as possible. Because ultimately, it's not about, you know, public sector or private sector. It's about getting the best possible healthcare that we can to as many people as we can in our country. So with that overall goal in mind, I think if we have this partnership approach and we understand each other's perspectives and we try to take one step forward from each side, I think that's really the best way forward from this.
Okay, indeed, that is the best way forward in all aspects, moving ahead in tandem with each other and trying to achieve the goals which have been set out there. Thank you so much, Urvashi and Mr. Panigrahi as well, for your views and insights on this very important aspect of the healthcare sector, that is the investment opportunities, has been outlined by Niti Aayog in its report, and as Urvashi was also referring to, and Mr. Panigrahi giving his point of view in terms of the industry experience. That's all we have in this edition of Big Picture. We'll come back again tomorrow with a different topic. Till then, keep watching. Thank you.